سبايا سبايا وراس حسين ينظرهم سبايا من كربلاء للشام أخذوهم سبايا سبايا وينك يا علي يا حامل حمير وينك يا علي يا حامي الحمية يا
بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين بارئ الخلائق أجمعين، والحمد لله الذي بعد فلا يرى وقرب فشهد النجوى تبارك وتعالى، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيب قلوبنا وطبيب نفوسنا وشفيع ذنوبنا أبو القاسم محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا.
اللهم صل على محمد.
واللعنة الدائمة على أعدائهم ومبغضيهم وغاصب حقوقهم ومنكر فضائلهم ومناقبهم من أول يوم ظلمهم إلى لقاء يوم الدين، أما بعد. سلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. Our assembly and congregation this evening is to commemorate the wafat of the daughter of Ali ibn Abi Talib and Fatima al-Zahra, Hazrat Janab Zainab salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayha. Indeed, on an occasion like this, to speak about Janab Zainab and her life, to learn lessons from it, to attend an occasion of the wafat or the wiladat of these personalities is an insignificant and humble effort of ours to express our love towards the Ahlul Bayt alayhimu salatu wassalam. For us to have left home and come all the way here to commemorate or to celebrate any occasion of any illuminated personality is our insignificant effort to express our love towards them. Because the Holy Prophet of Islam mentions, لَا قُلْ لَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرًا إِلَّا الْمَوَدَّةَ فِي الْقُرْبَى. Say unto them that I do not seek any recompense in what I have done for you, except that I want you in return to love and to express love towards my Ahlul Bayt alayhimu salatu wassalam. So this is our insignificant effort, our insignificant expression of love towards the Ahlul Bayt alayhimu salatu wassalam. With the time that I have before me right now, I wish to concentrate on learning something from the life of this lady, particularly in light of Islam and contemporary issues that affect our lives on a daily basis. It is for us to understand that during the time when the Holy Prophet of Islam, Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, when he came and brought Islam before people, it is interesting to know the lives and the culture and the values of the people who lived at that particular time to be able to fully appreciate the life of Janab Zainab, the life of Hazrat Zahra, and the life of the ladies who were associated with the Holy Prophet of Islam. It is interesting to note that the people of the time of Jahiliyyah were people who were totally immersed in material gains, who were totally people who had no value. Able to understand the lives of our Imam alayhi salatu wa salam, to be able to understand the lives of the ladies and of the Holy Prophet of Islam, it is important to go into history very briefly so that we can speak about Janab Zainab. Pre-Islam, there was within the culture of the people, or those people who were known as people who lived in the period or era of Jahiliyyah, the Arabs of that time who were Bedouins. It was a lawless society, a society that had no law. When I say lawless, there were certain laws in which they, to which they subscribed, but in relation to our lives, it was a lawless society. There was, if one person killed one member of my family, then another person from my family will definitely kill the member of his family. And this feud would go on for centuries. For years, they would just go on killing each member of each other's family. Man used to marry, and this is history, and do not get shocked by the figures. All you need to do is just refer to history and you will know this is pre-Islam, the period of Jahiliyyah. Man used to marry a woman so that she could bear children for him. He used to marry a woman so that she could look after his children for him. She was nothing but an object of sex for man. She had absolutely no rights whatsoever. She was not given even the basic human rights. In fact, the jahala, or the degradation of women that took place prior to the announcement of the period of Islam, was such that when a father used to marry, he used to marry as many women as he liked. There was no law. He could find any woman and he would marry any woman. He could prefer and like any woman, he could take that woman. He could sit in ambush against any caravan that was passing there and pick up a woman and make him his wife. A slave and concubines would become his wives. To the extent, the period of Jahala and the degradation of women was to the extent that when the father used to die, he used to leave all his wives except the woman who gave birth to his eldest son. The eldest son used to inherit all the wives of the father as wives and not even mothers. That was the period of Jahiliyyah. The figures given are 250 to 300 women one man used to marry. This is pre-Islam. Man used to have absolutely no regard for a woman. We have the first Muslim woman to have sacrificed her life for Islam is known as Sumayya. Sumayya was the mother of Ammar. Ammar was the son of Yasir. So Yasir and Sumayya were the parents of Ammar. Ammar was a young man who acknowledged and accepted Islam in the hands of the Holy Prophet of Islam. He used to leave, although they thought he was insane, although people thought that Ammar was taken over by the Holy Prophet of Islam, even Yasir and Sumayya were unhappy that he had converted to Islam or was influenced by the words of the Holy Prophet. But Ammar nevertheless used to leave home in the morning and come back in the evening on a daily basis. There was one day that Ammar did not return throughout the night. Both Yasir and Sumayya were extremely worried about Ammar that he had not returned. Until the morning, Sumayya, as a mother, was so worried about her son Ammar that she waited at the door, at the threshold of her house, to see where Ammar was. When he arrived at home, expressing her anger and saying whatever she wanted to say, she said to her son, "Where have you been all night, my son? Did you not care that your father and mother were worried about you?" And Ammar said, "Mother, I was with the Holy Prophet of Islam and I apologize. But I was mesmerized by something that was transpiring in the presence of the Holy Prophet of Islam." So Sumayya says, "Tell me, what was it that was happening?" And Ammar says, "I was sitting by the Holy Prophet of Islam in his presence. And there was a revelation that was being revealed unto the Holy Prophet. And I was listening to this revelation through the lips of the Holy Prophet and the profound knowledge that he was giving us." So by order of revelation, the fourth surah of Quran that was revealed, the Quran that we have today is a compiled Quran. You will see Surah Al-Baqarah is a large surah and then the smaller one. And then sometimes it moves away as a large or a small one. But that is not how the revelation has taken place. By order of revelation, the fourth surah that was revealed to the Holy Prophet of Islam is known as Surah Al-Kubwirat, which today in this particular compilation appears in the last sipara, in the 30th juz. It comes there. By order of revelation, it was the fourth surah that was revealed to the Holy Prophet of Islam. In this surah, the wordings begin, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوِّرَتْ وَإِذَا النُّجُومُ كَدَرَتْ وَإِذَا الْبِحَارُ سُجِّرَتْ. When you go further, there is a question that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala places there and asks, وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. When it will be asked about this young infant child, what was the crime for which it used to be killed and buried alive? So there was a tribe who did not regard a woman to be even a human being. She used to be killed and buried alive. This is pre-Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala records this in Quran. He says, Bismillah, Surah An-Nahl. He says, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. وَإِذَا بُشِّرَ أَحَدُهُمْ بِالْأُنْثَى. Allah says, when a father used to be given glad tidings that a daughter was born to him, that a baby girl was born to him. This is Quran, Surah An-Nahl. Allah says, وَإِذَا بُشِّرَ أَحَدُهُمْ بِالْأُنْثَى. When a father used to be given glad tidings that a daughter was born to him, ظَلَّ وَجْهُهُ مُسْوَدًّا وَهُوَ كَظِيمٌ. The face of the father used to turn dark with anger. His face, he was enraged by the notion that a daughter was born to him. So Allah records this, ظَلَّ وَجْهُهُ مُسْوَدًّا وَهُوَ كَظِيمٌ. His face used to turn dark with anger. No, it doesn't end there. يَتَوَارَ مِنَ الْقَوْمِ مِنْ سُوءِ مَا بُشِّرَ بِهِ. This father used to move around his contemporaries and the people of his community, and he used to hide away his face, a feeling embarrassed that a daughter was born to him. This was the state of the father. A, he used to become dark with anger. Two, he used to hide away his face from the members of his community, يَتَوَارَ مِنَ الْقَوْمِ مِنْ سُوءِ مَا بُشِّرَ بِهِ, because he was given bad news that a daughter was born to him. And then Allah says, he used to think, أَيُمْسِكُهُ عَلَىٰ هُونٍ أَمْ يَدُسُّهُ فِي التُّرَابِ. He used to think whether he should live with this humiliation that he had a baby girl, a child in his house who was a daughter, أَمْ يَدُسُّهُ فِي التُّرَابِ, or should he bury his daughter alive. أَلَا سَاءَ مَا يَحْكُمُونَ. What an evil judgment they used to do, because they used to bury their daughters alive. When Sumayya was told by Ammar Yasir that these were the verses that were being revealed, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to question why and what was the crime of these little girls that were being buried alive, Sumayya looks at her son for the first time, listening to him, giving him a patient ear, and then saying to her son, tell me, who is this man who is speaking about the values of mankind, who is speaking about the rights of women? Show me this man so that I may go and submit before him. That was the life of all these women at that particular time. Think about this now. This is the history of pre-Islam. Under such circumstances, when a woman had no value, when a man used to marry more than 250 wives, or when the son used to inherit the wives of the father, his own mothers as his wives, except the one who had given birth to him, you can imagine what that state was. For you to have a daughter in your house was considered to be a taboo, was a big problem. People used to pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that they do not want a baby girl. But nothing has changed though. I will come to it in a minute. Nothing has changed. Not much has changed. what happens at that particular time? Because the father did not want a child. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his wisdom decides to give the Holy Prophet of Islam nothing but a daughter in the person of Fatima to Zahra salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. You know, when the Holy Prophet of Islam used to give sermons sitting on the pulpit, and he had companions sitting next to him, and he was delivering sermons. This was Rasulullah. This was not an ordinary human being. He was delivering sermons. That means he was speaking the language that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had asked him to speak. He was conveying the message that Allah wanted them to listen to. But when Fatima used to walk in through the door of Masjidun Nabawi, the Holy Prophet of Islam used to stand up. We say that this standing up was probably because of the expression of love towards Fatima that the Holy Prophet of Islam had. That's what we think it is. But it's a very simplistic way of looking at the status of Fatima. Surely, I mean, I have a daughter. I can probably stand once or twice when she comes back from school, but I don't think I will stand for my daughter in the middle of this pulpit when she walks in. This will be something that I will probably not do, and I don't think you will either. If you were sitting in my particular position, you would also not do that. So the Holy Prophet of Islam's action at that particular time is not because he was expressing love for Fatima. No, he was standing up for someone who was his partner in conveying the message of Islam. She was Shariq of Risalat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was not standing up for her as a daughter. He was showing to the world the right that a woman has, the right that has been given to her by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, the Holy Prophet of Islam gave Hazrat Zahra titles that you and I talk about and think about them as a fadilat, as an excellence only, and don't think about what it actually means. When the Holy Prophet of Islam says, Fatima to Ummu Abiha, Fatima is the mother of her father, know that the one who is uttering these words is Rasulullah, who does not speak except that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks him to speak. So when he speaks about Zahra and he says, Fatima to Ummu Abiha, Fatima is the mother of her father, the Holy Prophet of Islam means something for you and I to understand. When he used to come home feeling rejected, no. When he used to come home feeling defeated, when he used to come home having received stones from the people, when people used to use abusive language against the Holy Prophet of Islam, whenever he came home, it was that five-year-old child called Fatima who used to open her arms before her father and say, Oh my father, I believe in you. Continue with your mission, for I am with you. So he did not miss his mother by looking at Fatima. No, Fatima played the role of the mother for Rasulullah to be able to complete his mission. But all these things were being done for what purpose? For the Holy Prophet of Islam to make a distinction, to show to the world that a woman has a right. I mean, it is not a subject that we can speak about in one majlis. However, I will try my utmost best. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the spiritual realm talks about the status of woman, Allah does not make any distinction. This distinction has been made by a human being, and I will prove it to you in a minute. Allah makes no distinction because in the spiritual realm, there is no gender. There is no male or female in the spiritual realm. Physically, there is a need for them to be different for continuity of the same species, for them to be able to live in harmony. That's why there will be a physical difference and distinction between a man and a woman. But when it comes to the spiritual realm, there is absolutely no difference between a man and a woman. When it comes to rewards, you see, these are myths that people have come with. And they have crept into the books, religious texts as well. When we hear that Hawa was born from the rib of Adam. Or she was created from the rib of Adam, alayhi salam. Where did this come from? Which hadith actually talks about this? And how can you authenticate this hadith? And when you talk about this, then you do not exclude Fatima al-Zahra unless you call her not somebody who is not a woman. You cannot do that. Is a woman created from the rib of a man? Or in modern Europe, about 100 and something years ago, there was a debate whether women and black people were even human beings or not. And you will find this in the annals of history, even here in the United Kingdom. There was a debate that took place whether a woman was a human being or not, and black people were human beings or not. Gradually, they called a woman subhuman. Not a full human, but a subhuman. That title was given to a woman that she was not a human being, but she was a subhuman. And then gradually she got the title of a woman and then given the rights of being able to own a property and also be able to inherit. Allahu Akbar. Rasulullah did this 1400 years ago. Quran and Majid spoke about the rights of woman. As a mother, she inherits. As a wife, she inherits. As a daughter, she inherits. As a person who is the mother of a child, she inherits. Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam makes no distinction whatsoever between a man and a woman. Let us see what Quran says. Quran says, in those who know Arabic language, and I hope some of you do, those who understand Arabic language will know that in grammatical sense of the word, when you say Muslim, when I say Muslims to you, it includes men as well as women. Even in English, when I say Muslims, it includes men as well as women. When in Arabic language you say Muslimin, you are including men and women. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't want you and I to understand it that way. In Surah Al-Ahzab, verse number 36, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala separates them. But at the end, He brings them together. How does He do it? He says, إِنَّ الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَالْمُسْلِمَاتِ وَالْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ وَالْقَانِتِينَ وَالْقَانِتَاتِ وَالصَّابِرِينَ وَالصَّابِرَاتِ وَالْخَاشِعِينَ وَالْخَاشِعَاتِ وَالصَّادِقِينَ وَالصَّادِقَاتِ وَالْمُتَصَدِّقِينَ وَالْمُتَصَدِّقَاتِ والذاكرين الله كثيرا والذاكرات والصائمين والصائمات أعد الله لهم مغفرة وأجرا عظيما. He separates male and female. He says Muslims men and Muslim women, believing men, believing women, obeying men, obeying women, truthful men, truthful women, fasting men, fasting women, those who remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala oft, men, and those who remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala oft, women. Charity giving men, charity giving women. All these things Allah says. But at the end He says, أَعَدَّ اللَّهُ لَهُمْ مَغْفِرَةً وَأَجْرًا عَظِيمًا. Allah has promised the reward for them. And a great reward for them in the hereafter. Not for men only. That reward is not for men only. Now let me tell you how these things have crept in within our book. Sometimes even within the law system. Think about this. You open the books of dua and supplication. Even, you know, even I used to do this in my days when I did not understand what I was doing. Even I used to do this. And sometimes, you know, we are so used to listen to things in our heads and then believe that those are the things. For example, and sometimes even sitting here in the majlis, I could make a mistake and you could just listen to me and not say a word. One day I made a mistake. Somewhere I recited a majlis. And I had this crammed thing in my head in which I used to do the dua at the end. And I used to say, پالنے والے ہم بہت گنہ گار ہیں ہمارے گناہوں کو معاف فرما. And people used to say الہی آمین. Correct? Those who understand اردو, پالنے والے ہم بہت گنہ گار ہیں تو ہمارے گناہوں کو معاف فرما. One day I made a mistake. It was a slip of a tongue. I said پالنے والے ہم بہت گنہ گار ہیں ہمارے گناہوں کو اپنی بارگاہ میں قبول فرما. That's what I said by mistake. it was a mistake, it was a slip of a tongue, and I said, accept my guna. But my mistake was a mistake. The masses says, Ilahi Amin too. That is how we listen to the majlises sometimes. It's just passing by. You know, sometimes when we read supplications, when we read du'as, open the books of du'as, and even from the pulpits, you will hear us saying, Palne wale jo be aulad hai, unko aulade narina ata farma. You know what narina means? Male issue. Even now, when we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are asking Allah to give us a male child. Where does it come from? Why do we have a problem with a daughter? Those of us who have daughters, there is nothing more beautiful than a daughter. There is nothing more that can give you sukoon than a daughter. Some people go to the extent of this myth and superstitions. You call your daughter Zainab. And if she falls sick often, you say this name is heavy on her. Where does it come from? Where do I bring all these things from? It is these ideas that have given you and I. Even today when we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are asking for a male issue. We do not want daughters. Why? Because that is what they used to say at that time. That if a daughter was born to you, it was a bad omen. Allah gives the Holy Prophet of Islam, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, nothing but Fatima Zahra. I am aware of the time, and as I said, I will not be able to complete what I have started. But in light of what I have just mentioned to you today, when we look at the verse of Surah Al-Ahzab, verse number 36 that I recited before you, Allah says, "Innal mu'minina, innal muslimina wal muslimat." Indeed, all submitting men and submitting women. I want to look at Janab Zainab in light of this particular verse. I have to, and you have to acknowledge that there is absolutely no difference, and the differences have been made by human beings who were male dominant at that particular time. And that has caused huge amounts of problems. There are differences which the Holy Prophet of Islam has mentioned today. Just for an example, and I deal with these issues on a daily basis. When a man wants a divorce in the Muslim Ummah, within the Muslim Ummah, in the law system, when a man wants to divorce a woman, all he needs to do is say talaq 3 times. And that's it. He's off the hook. He's over. It's finished. In other madhahib, for example, like ours, all man has to do is say, I want to divorce my wife. He can come to me or any mulana, any alim, and go and say that I want to divorce my wife. And it is as simple as him giving a consent. But if a woman wants to have a divorce, and genuinely as well, do you know how long it takes for her to get a divorce? Do you know what she has to go through to get a divorce? Where does it come from? When we study Islam and we begin to realize that there are some historical and contextual issues that we need to look at, we begin to see that that was not how Rasulullah was dealing with the issues of women. That is not how Ali ibn Abi Talib was dealing with issues of women. Today, Al-Taliban does not want girls to study. And we have the embodiment of the girl who wants to study, or we have somebody who here in United Kingdom who wanted to be killed by the Taliban is here standing for the rights of women so that they could study. So Taliban have made an interpretation of Islam that a woman cannot go to school if she wants to go. While Amirul Mu'mineen says, regarding your daughters, وَعَلِّمُوهُنَّ الْقُرْآنَ وَالدِّينَ وَالْحِسَابَ وَالْخِيَاطَ. Teach them Quran, teach them religion, teach them accountancy, teach them how to stitch. And these are only symbols that he mentions. Teach them, educate them. There is nothing that stops a woman from becoming educated whatsoever. When Amirul Mu'mineen once comes back from Masjid al-Kufa, only to find, you know, those who have been to Masjid al-Kufa, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take them. Those who have not been, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala go take them and give them the opportunity to go, and those who have been, may Allah take them again and again. When you go to Masjid al-Kufa, when you come out, you go to the house of Amirul Mu'mineen. When Amirul Mu'mineen came, it was not in this setting as it is now. When Amirul Mu'mineen once comes out of Masjid al-Kufa and goes to his house, he finds that the house is full of women, overflowing until outside his house. He stopped for a while. He did not know what was happening. After a while, he went, and a lady came to him and said, "Ya Ali, your daughter Zainab is doing tafsir, is teaching the women of Kufa the tafsir of Sami Allahu liman hamida. She is teaching them the exegesis of Sami Allahu liman hamida, the statement Allah listens to those who praise Him." That was the knowledge. Imam Zainul Abidin regarding Janabi Zainab says, "Anti alimatun ghayru mu'allama." You are an alima who has not been taught by anyone. There was no restriction in study whatsoever. Let us look at Janabi Zainab tabarrukan, just for the blessings of the day, in light of these verses, or this particular verse, each one of it. Can there be anyone who is more submissive after Zahra than Zainab salamullahi alayha? When we look at Inna al-Muslimina wal-Muslimat, she is the true servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has wholeheartedly submitted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wal-Mu'minina wal-Mu'minat, those who have, you see, Muslim is through tongue, Iman is through the heart. When it comes to Janabi Zainab, her Iman is not an ordinary Iman. Then let us look at the third part of the verse, which says, وَالْقَانِتِينَ وَالْقَانِتَاتِ, the obeying man and the obeying women. Imam Zainul Abidin says, مَا زَالَتْ عَمَّتِي قَائِمَةٌ تِلْكَ اللَّيْلَةِ. Even on the night of Ashura, even on the night of Ashura, when it comes to obedience, my aunt Janabi Zainab was the true person who obeyed every command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through Abu Abdullah al-Husayn salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. So, مَا زَالَتْ عَمَّتِي قَائِمَةٌ تِلْكَ اللَّيْلَةِ, on that particular night, in obedience to the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, she stood to pray her salat. She stood to obey the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَالصَّادِقِينَ وَالصَّادِقَاتِ, truthful men and truthful women. When it comes to truthfulness, a title given to Janabi Zainab is Siddiqatu Sughra, one who speaks the truth. No, every fiber of her existence speaks the truth. Every fiber of her existence is nothing but the truth in itself. وَالصَّابِرِينَ وَالصَّابِرَاتِ, she is known as Ummu al-Masa'ib. وَالصَّابِرِينَ وَالصَّابِرَاتِ, in patient men and patient women, can there be anyone more patient than Zainab? And I will mention to you in a moment what her patience is. She is Sharikatul Hussein fil Musiba. She is the partner of Hussein ibn Ali in the calamities that befell on her. Imam Zaman in Ziyarat Nahiya says, قَدْ عَجَبَتْ فِي صَبْرِكَ مَلَائِكَةُ السَّمَاوَاتِ. He refers to Janabi Zainab. And he says, even the angels in the heavens were surprised at the level of patience of Zainab salamullahi alayha. Her knowledge, Imam Zainul Abidin gives her a medal. Anti alimatun ghayru mu'allama. You are an alima who has not been taught by anyone. Wal mutasaddiqina wal mutasaddiqat, charity giving men and charity giving women, those who give sadaqah. those who give in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know what Janabi Zainab mentioned? On the 11th of Muharram, when the captive's caravan was moved from the area of the tents and were now being taken away from Karbala to Kufa, before that they were passed around the bodies of the dead people, of those who had already died, of those who were already martyred. And she was brought to the body of Aba Abdullah al-Hussein alayhi salatu wassalam. You know, this is what we say, giving in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She was brought by the body of Aba Abdullah, a body that did not have a head, a body that was already trampled under the hooves of the horses, a body that had no clothes whatsoever. Allahu Akbar. Only Zainab can tell us what she was feeling at that particular time. She looked at the body of her brother Hussein, and you know what she uttered, the words that she uttered, and this is what giving in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means. You know what she said? She said, Allahumma taqabbal minna hadha al-qaleel min al-qurban. Oh Allah, accept this little qurbani of ours. Accept this little sacrifice of ours. Oh Zainab, you call Hussein little? Was that a little sacrifice? But when it comes to the spirit of giving, and the spirit of giving in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is what Janabi Zainab did. Fasting men and fasting women. Janabi Sakina says that if there was one person in the tents of Hussein ibn Ali who had least amount of water in Karbala, it was none other than Zainab. She had the least amount of water in Karbala. Janabi Zainab says, every time water was brought, she offered it to the children first. And what was left, she gave it to the women and to the people who were there. But she was so weak. She was so weak by the time of Ashura, so weak that Imam Zain al-Abidin says, I saw my aunt praying her salat of tahajjud in a sitting position because she was thirsty. She was dehydrated by the tent of Muharram. وَالْحَافِذِينَ فُرُوجَهُمْ وَالْحَافِظَاتِ. And those who protect their chastity, men and women, on the day of Ashura in Sham-e Ghariba, you know, when the veils were taken away from the heads of the women, at that time Janabi Zainab was running helplessly from one tent to the other and from the other to the third. Eventually she reached the tent of Imam Zainul Abidin and says to him, Sayyidi Sajjad, you are the Imam of our time. Oh Sayyidi Sajjad, oh my son, tell me, what am I supposed to do in relation to protecting my chastity, in relation to protecting my iffah, in relation to protecting my integrity as the daughter of Ali ibn Abi Talib? Sayyidi Sajjad, tell me, what am I supposed to do? Am I supposed to remain here and burn in this burning tent? Or do you say that we walk out of these tents without hijab? Imam Zainul Abidin says to her, oh Aunt Zainab, it is wajib to save your life at this particular moment. I command that you leave these tents. For the first time when Janabi Zainab left those tents, she slept on her face and wept and cried and said, wa hijaba, where is my hijab? What has happened to my hijab? That is how she protected herself. Wa dhakirina. وَالذَّاكِرِينَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا وَالذَّاكِرَاتِ. Those who remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala often. What more can I say? Imam Hussein, who is a ma'soom, tells his sister, who is a not ma'soom of the level of Hussein ibn Ali. What does Imam Hussein say to her? When you stand up for your namaz-e-shab, do not forget your brother Hussein ibn Ali, because he trusted the dhikr of Janab Zainab with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Azadarane Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wassalam. Do jumle masaib ke sun lijega. Ajeeb o ghareeb baat hai. Janab Zainab 56 ya 57 saal سال کی عمر تھی جناب زینب کی کربلا میں، کتنی تھکی ہوئی تھی جناب زینب، ذرا اس کا اندازہ لگائیے. صبح سے لے کے کربلا، جب مدینہ سے روانہ ہوئے تب جناب زینب ساتھ میں تھیں، مدینہ کے بعد جب مکہ پہنچے تب جناب زینب ساتھ میں تھیں، مکے سے جب کربلا پہنچے تب جناب زینب ساتھ میں تھیں، صبح سے لے کر جناب زینب جب جہاں بھی کوئی لاشا گرتا تھا، حسین جب جاتے تھے لاشے کو اٹھانے کے لیے تو جناب زینب ساتھ ساتھ جاتی تھی، جب علی اکبر گھوڑے سے زمین پہ تشریف لائے جناب زینب ساتھ میں گئی، جب علی اصغر کا ننا سا گلا تین بھال کے تیر سے چھدا، حسین ابن علی جب واپس پلٹ کے آئے ہیں تو ایک مرتبہ زینب کو آواز دی، بہن زینب رباب کو سنبھالو، میں علی اصغر کو لے کر آیا ہوں. زینب ساتھ میں تھی، جب عباس کے بازو قلم ہوئے زینب ساتھ میں تھی، ارے جب قاسم کا پامال لاشا خیموں میں آیا زینب ساتھ میں تھی. زینب کتنی تھکی ہوئی تھی، بس اس کا اندازہ فقط زینب لگا سکتی ہے. ہاں عزادارو، یہ جناب زینب ہے، یہ جناب زینب ہے جن کے بارے میں یہ ملتا ہے، جناب زینب کے مصائب کے بارے میں ملتا ہے کہ جناب زینب نے گریا جب بھی کربلا کے بعد گریا کیا، کبھی حسین پہ گریا کیا، کبھی عباس پہ گریا کیا، کبھی قاسم پہ گریا کیا، کبھی علی اکبر پہ گریا کیا، مگر جناب زینب کے بارے میں یہ ملتا ہے کہ کہیں بھی آپ کو یہ نہیں ملے گا کہ اون و محمد پہ جناب زینب نے گریا کیا ہو، کہیں نہیں ملے گا کہ اون و محمد پہ گریا کیا ہو. واہ حسینہ، واہ عباسہ، واہ علیہ، واہ قاسمہ کی آوازیں بلند کرتی تھی، مگر کبھی بھی اون و محمد پہ گریا نہیں کیا. اسادارو آپ سنیں گے، ایک مرتبہ جناب زینب جب زندان شام سے واپس نکل کے آئی ہیں، جب زندان شام سے رہائی ملی ہے تو تمام بیبیوں کو اپنے اپنے شہداء کے سر واپس لوٹائے گئے. جناب امام حسین کا سر آیا، زینب نے سینے سے لگا لیا، عباس کا سر آیا، جناب ام کلثوم نے سینے سے لگا لیا، علی اکبر کا سر آیا، ایک مرتبہ ام لیلہ آگے بڑھی، علی اکبر کے سر کو اٹھا لیا. اس طرح ایک ایک سر آتا گیا، بیبیاں اٹھاتی گئیں، دو چھوٹے چھوٹے سر ایک مرتبہ لائے گئے جس کا اٹھانے والا کوئی نہ تھا. کسی نے پوچھا، کربلا میں ان دو بچوں کی ماں نہ تھی، آواز آئی، خبردار یہ زینب کے دونوں نہال، خبردار یہ زینب کے دونوں نہال ہے. زینب نے گریہ نہیں کیا، زینب نے گریہ نہیں کیا. عزاداروں، پہلی مرتبہ زینب نے کب گریا کیا آپ جانتے ہیں؟ جناب زینب نے کب گریا کیا، کیا حالت تھی جناب زینب کی؟ جناب زینب کے بارے میں عبداللہ ابن جعفر جناب زینب کے شوہر روایت کرتے ہیں، میں نے دیکھا میرے گھر کے باہر ایک ضعیف عورت کھڑی ہوئی ہے جس کی کمر جھکی ہوئی ہے. میں آگے بڑھا، میں نے پوچھا، یا امت اللہ، اے اللہ کی کنیز، هل لك من حاجہ، کیا تمہاری کوئی حاجت ہے؟ ایک مرتبہ اس عورت نے اپنے نقاب کو الٹ کے کہا، اے ابن عم، نہ پہچانا میں زینب ہوں، پہچانا میں زینب ہوں. یہ کہہ کے جناب زینب پہلی مرتبہ اپنے گھر کے اندر داخل ہوئی. خدا کسی ماں کو اجڑا ہوا گھر نہ دکھائے، ایک مرتبہ اپنے گھر کے اندر داخل ہوئی. خدا جانے زینب کے دل کی کیا کیفیت تھی، مگر گھر کے اندر آنے کے بعد پہلی مرتبہ گریا کر کے کہا، اون و محمد کو یاد کر کے کہا، اے ابن عم، اون کا پرسہ قبول کیجئے، اے ابن عم، محمد کا پرسہ قبول کیجئے. مگر زینب کی کیا حالت ہو گئی تھی. ایک جملہ اور اس کے بعد میں انشاءاللہ آپ کی زحمتوں کو تمام کر دوں گا. جناب زینب کی کیا حالت ہو گئی تھی. علامہ جواد آملی صاحب، آیت اللہ جواد آملی صاحب، اپنی تقریر میں ارشاد فرماتے ہیں، جب جناب زینب کو کوفے کی طرف لے جایا گیا اور جناب زینب نے اپنے بھائی حسین کا لاشا بے گور و کفن، جناب زینب نے حسین کا لاشا دیکھا تھا کوفہ جانے سے پہلے، تب جناب زینب کی زبان سے ایک جملہ نکلا تھا، اور بس اس جملے کو آپ سنیے گا، تصور شرط ہے، اس سے آگے میں کچھ پڑھ نہیں پاؤں گا. جناب زینب نے ایک جملہ کہا تھا، اپنے اس بھائی کی باڈی کو، اپنے اس بھائی کے لاشے کو دیکھ کر ایک جملہ کہا تھا. یہ کون زینب ہے آپ جانتے ہیں؟ جب جناب زینب کی شادی ہوئی تھی عبداللہ ابن جعفر کے ساتھ، جب جناب زینب کی عبداللہ ابن جعفر کے ساتھ شادی ہوئی تھی تو مولا کائنات جناب زینب کے گھر پہ دوسرے دن آئے تھے تو جناب زینب کو روتا ہوا دیکھا، بہت گریہ کر رہی تھی جناب زینب. مولا کائنات نے جناب زینب سے اس وقت پوچھا تھا، بیٹا زینب کیا بات ہے، کیوں گریہ کر رہی ہو، کیا تم خوش نہیں ہو؟ فرمایا نہیں بابا بہت خوش ہوں. فرمایا یہ گریہ کرنے کا کیا سبب ہے، یہ سسکیاں لینے کا کیا سبب ہے، شادی کے دوسرے دن یہ سسکیاں لینے کا کیا سبب ہے؟ اب جانتے ہیں زینب نے کیا جواب دیا تھا، کہا بابا میں اس لیے گریہ کر رہی ہوں، آپ کو نہیں معلوم کتنے پہر گزر گئے، زینب نے اپنے بھائی حسین کو نہیں دیکھا. وہ زینب جب جناب زینب کو اس جگہ لایا گیا جہاں اپنے بھائی کا لاشا بے گور و کفن پڑا ہوا تھا، وہاں زینب نے اپنے بھائی کے لاشے کو دیکھا اور دیکھنے کے بعد جناب زینب نے جملہ کہا، اس سے آپ لاشے کا اندازہ لگا سکتے ہیں. جناب زینب نے جملہ کہا، کیا جملہ کہا؟ انت اخی، کیا آپ میرے بھائی حسین ہیں؟ یہ جناب زینب نے جملہ کہا، کیا آپ میرے بھائی حسین ہیں. علامہ جواد عاملی کہتے ہیں ایسے عالم میں جناب حسین کو، جناب امام، جناب زینب کو لے جایا گیا. کربلا سے کوفہ گئیں، کوفے سے شام آئیں، شام سے جب رہائی ملی ہے اور جناب زینب پلٹ کے واپس آئیں ہیں، اللہ آیت اللہ جواد عاملی کہتے ہیں حسین کی قبر پہ آئیں جناب زینب، حسین کی قبر پہ آئیں جناب زینب اور اپنے آپ کو حسین کی قبر پہ گرا دیا اور فرمایا بھیا زینب کربلا فتح، زینب شام فتح کر کے آ گئی، بھیا زینب یزید کو فتح کر کے آ گئی، زینب یزید کو نیست و نابود کر کے آ گئی، بھیا شام کا تخت کو الٹ کے زینب آ گئی. جواد عاملی کہتے ہیں عجب نہیں زینب کی حالت دیکھ کے قبر سے آواز آئی ہو، کیا تم میری بہن زینب ہو؟
سیعلم الذین ظلموا ای منقلب ینقلبون انا للہ و انا الیہ
سهم انصابك يبكي انصابك يا بول يمه لما انصابك سهم انصابك يبكي انصابك يا بول يمه